had a delightful little break. I certainly did. I've got a cappuccino with me. Very nice indeed. Afro coffee. Fair trade. Very nice indeed. So, yes. Thank you very much to the Austrian GP Media Centre for that one, keeping us fueled for what is certain to be another hard and fast MotoE qualifying session. Q1 coming your way in just a moment's time. The top two riders from that will proceed into Q2. Those are the all-important ones. Of course, MotoE has been to Austria a fair few times by now, but not with this brand new layout, of course. I should stress that. I won't lie to you. I'm scrambling to find my notes and the PDFs from the free practices because, there we go, I've got them now. It was actually quite a surprise. There is one rider that is really nailing it here so far today in the dry and the wet, in fact. And that is Mattia Cassadei. So, looks like, let me just confirm it because we have had some issues so far. Okay, we're correct. So, those are the guaranteed riders on the right, down P1 to P8 from FP2 combined sessions. They are through to Q2. The ones on the right, we're about to see them come out on track. Some big hitters in there, the likes of Jordi Torres, Kevin Zanoni, who has been very, very fast recently as well. So those are the riders we'll be seeing battling it out for those two positions extra going into Q2. MotoE this morning, well, they were first out on track bright and early. In fact, when we were coming into the car, we had to cross the track for where the MotoE bikes come from at the MotoE paddock through into pit lane. We had to wait for them. It was like a pedestrian crossing, but for motorcycles, electric ones at that too. So they were out so early, the track was still very, very wet indeed. So they really got wet running of it this morning. Mattia Cassadei was the fastest rider there, a 149.2, but they shaved 8 seconds off in the dry over midday. The lunch break that we had earlier on between FP1 and FP2 sessions in the Grand Prix classes, Cassadei was faster yet again there, a 141.7. But this is his teammate, Jordi Torres. He actually finished in 12th in the combined free practice sessions. We should be seeing Jordi, well, a bit more fighting fit this weekend, I should say. Neil, of course, he suffered that leg break injury back in a nasty crash in Le Mans, which really put paid to his championship hopes. But I wonder how he's dealing with the new chicane. And of course, not just the new chicane here, Neil, but also they have got that new front end. The bikes are different from previously. The new front tyre constructions, that's presenting all new challenges for our MotoE riders this weekend.
Yeah, not just this weekend, but also this year. I think that's been one of the big things for these guys to try and get their heads around for 2022. Obviously, MotoE bikes in 2022 are a good deal lighter than we had previously in this championship, and obviously that changes the characteristics, especially on the front end. Someone like Bradley Smith, who obviously missed the first couple of rounds through injury, he's having some difficulties trying to get his head round the new characteristics of this year's bike. But other couple of guys, obviously the top guys in the championship, haven't really had such issues with the likes of Egerton, Granado, Ferrari and Cassadei.
Here is Bradley Smith then, properly returning to action this weekend. He was in Assen, of course, but one race and two laps wasn't really much time for him to get up to speed. He had a podium the last time he visited here in MotoE in 2019. Not been such a happy start to the weekend for him. He actually finished up free practice in 16th position. So he was a little bit more off the pace, 1.8 seconds adrift, but come the end of it, a 143.544. He will be very thankful, I should think, Neil, for the lack of e-pole and a one-off lap. At least these shorter qualifying sessions give riders a time to really build up and build it in. Great to see Cardalus returning to action as well, Neil.
Yep, absolutely. But we're going to pass down to Fran Wild, who is in pit lane with Bradley Smith himself. Fran.
I am in the nick of time. So, Bradley, just about you being on the bike, how are you feeling? All okay?
Yeah, generally okay. Unfortunately, the little slip off this morning. Struggling in the dry, still can't find a base setting. But, I mean, to be expected given the experience that I have, I hope that we find something now.
Oh, well, thank you very much, Fran and Bradley Smith then. So, yeah, he had a little tip off this morning. Unfortunately, it seems all okay there. There's Kevin Manfredi. Good to see the number 34 out there. Oh, Kevin, number 34. Seen plenty of them in years gone by, haven't we? The flying mustache he is. Or is he still? We can't tell because of his helmet on at the moment, unfortunately. So, in addition to Bradley Smith crashing earlier, I'm just scrolling through my photos here to double check the incident forms that we receive at the end of action as well. So this was from first action this morning. We had, is this Moto E? I should hope it is. I'll tell you what, I'll come back to you anyways, because I'll tell you what, we'll go back to Fran in pit lane. She's actually caught Mattia Cassidy, the fastest rider from today so far.
I have indeed. So, Mattia, you were giving Jordi a bit of encouragement there. Obviously, he's going to head out in Q1. But you've got a bit of an advantage at the top. You're fastest out the blocks with 0.3 in hand. What's the secret, and how do you like the new chicane?
The secret is mine. No, I like the track. There is a lot of braking, and I like very much. And I enjoy this freak practice. Now we go focus on Coupé for see what happened. I hope to do a very good job.
So do you think for you, with the hard braking at the chicane, is that a good addition?
Yeah, for me, yes.
Cool, we'll see for everyone else then. Thank you, best of luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Fran and Mattia Cassidy. So no let up on what his secret is around it, because he was much faster than everybody else. You'll be pleased to know, after scrolling through various messages on WhatsApp, I have found the most two things. So, of course, Bradley Smith actually went down earlier. He went down this morning at turn one. Then there were two crashes at turn three as well. One for Matteo Ferrari and the other one for Alessio Finello. Not a great morning for the fellow Gresini Moto E squad.
Frank. Yeah, I was just going to add about Finello. He has been passed unfit, unfortunately, for this one. He's got a fracture, and I think it's his right foot. So, rider pretty okay, but unfortunately not able to take more part in this weekend.
Yes, thanks for that update, Fran. So that's a shame for Finello then. Won't be taking part in this session, even though he's on the boards there. There's Xavi Forrest then, the other Octo Pramac Moto e-rider. We see Bradley Smith coming across the line. He'll be setting his first flying lap. And this is the first that myself and Neil really get to see, of course, with no televised free practice for Moto E. This is the first time we get to see them navigate their ways through turns 2A and 2B up close. This morning, it looked like a very steady affair indeed in the wet.
Yeah, understandably so. And here is Bradley Smith talking about the need to try and find a decent base setting for this year. And we know Bradley Smith's pedigree, obviously a podium finisher at MotoGP, and one of the principal challengers in this class back in 2019 when it first launched, making his return this year, and obviously missing the first part of the season because of injury when he was endurance racing at the Le Mans 24 Hour. Injury to his back, and he made his comeback at Assen. But that was such a complicated weekend, wasn't it, Matt? With the weather, we had wet sessions, dry sessions, and obviously rain interrupted races as well. So far from ideal conditions for Bradley.
Well, let's pass back down to pit lane, though, as we watch Bradley Smith navigate his way through the final left-handers on the circuit. Fran Wiles caught the FIM president, Jorge Villegas.
I have indeed. Very VIP presence down in Moto E pit lane. Hello, how are you? And how are you enjoying Moto E trackside?
I always try to come here and see the riders and see the Moto E, because we invest very much in this class, and we keep investing. And I'm not saying this is the future, but it is an important sign that we are worried about the energetic transition.
Well, it's always a parallel path that we say about Moto E, but in terms of the competition, it's incredible and close racing, isn't it?
The competition is incredible. You have always 3, 4, 5 riders that can win, and all the races are good. So I really enjoy watching Moto E races, yes.
Me too. Well, folks, you heard it here first. Everyone loves Moto E. Definitely tune in.
Me first. I love Moto E first as well. Do you love Moto E as well, Neil?
I do, yeah. I mean, I just had to listen back to your commentary in the first race at Assen to understand
that you really love it.
to understand that you loved it, yeah. God. I haven't heard someone that excited, I think, in my life. But with good reason, to be fair.
Yeah, I get that excited every time I see you. Especially after the summer break and all that, Neil. Anyway, here's George Torres then. He was coming out of turn one, heading towards turns 2A and 2B. Bradley Smith, and no surprise that these times are coming tumbling down. 1:43.4, fastest time yet. Well, that's still 2 seconds or so off the fastest times that we saw back in free practice. However, that is the fastest lap that Bradley Smith has put down in Moto E in this new layout of Austria so far today.
Yeah, Bradley looks pretty good here, you have to say. Coming round through the switchback, turn 7 into 8, one of the more spectacular parts of this course. And we've had a couple of visits to this track with the MotoE World Cup, and it's been pretty impressive. I mean, oh, and Bradley has a bit of a moment there through turn nine, the rear stepping out ever so slightly. I think that will clearly impact his lap time. But hopefully he can still improve on this 43.4. 41.7 was the quickest time from FP2, Mattia Cassadei. With that one, Bradley gets it down to a 42.8.
Well then, let's head back down the pit lane then. One rider heading out in the next session, guaranteed. Matteo Ferrari, the number 11, the former double World Cup winner. And we can speak to him with Frank.
Indeed, it's the man himself. So, Matteo, you had a bit of a tip-off this morning, but obviously a bit of a crazy session for you guys to start the day. You did get the honour of being the first through the new chicane, but in very difficult conditions. How was it out in FP2, and what are you expecting from qualifying now?
Yeah, I was happy about this morning in the wet condition. In the FP2, I struggle a lot with the grip rear, but I think we did the good move on the bike on the setup, so I'm ready. And I think the most important thing, like always in Q2, is to stay in the first Euro. And I'll try to do my best, and we will see in a few minutes.
And you and Mattia obviously compete as well in other championships against each other and here. Do you ever compare any notes?
Yeah, it's really, really strange, because every year me and Mattia, we are in the same category, but it's fun fight with him. He's very strong, and in MotoE at the moment he's a little bit faster compared to me, but we will see tomorrow during the race.
I have to go and ask him for his secret. He wouldn't tell me.
No.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Fran and Ferrari there. Yeah, good crack as always, as we see Cardelus now on a pretty good lap. Good to see him back, of course, Neil. Number 18 was out through injury in Assen from a collision in Mugello.
Yeah, nasty crash it was for Cardelus, but he had shown occasional flashes of speed as Jory Torres goes up to second, but immediately demoted down to fourth. Cardelus third, Kevin Manfredi actually. It's a good performance from the Italian who goes into second, and it's actually the Japanese rider, Hikari Okubo, who currently leads this session. Okubo had a good race here last year, finishing fifth, so plenty of reason to expect the Japanese to be up there again.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey guys, sorry, just to butt in very briefly. Cardelus, I had the briefest of chats with him because Bradley was right on his way out and I was trying to complete your segue. And he said he's feeling okay and all good. Obviously, had a bit of a nightmare recently, both in this championship and in others. But yeah, he said he was all good to go and feeling pretty fighting fit.
Ah, that's nice to hear. Good job for Cardelus then. I was just going to throw it back to a year ago to remind you of what we saw. Even though there were two races here at the Red Bull Ring, we had in terms of Red Grand Prix weekends, there was one MotoE race, and it was Lukas Tulovic who took the victory there ahead of Eric Granado and Dominique Aigeter. Neil,
and
it's
Granado, I think, didn't he come through from way back on the grid? I think he had a bit of a duff qualifying. It was a pretty heroic recovery ride.
But so it was Fermín Aldeguer who was qualified on pole position, which we discussed, didn't we, in Moto2 FP2.
Big minute this for a couple of perhaps the more fancied contenders. I mean, Bradley Smith obviously not quite comfortable aboard the MotoE machinery just yet, and Jordi Torres, I have to say, a little surprised to see Jordi down in fifth. I'm not sure if the reigning World Cup winner will be on course to climb up the order here. He is just 0.5 off, but goes fastest only to be demoted by Cardelus. So can Torres keep that spot inside the top two?
Yeah, that's a big question. And back from Cardelus, it's actually the second 1:41 lap time we've had on this new layout in MotoE. Okubo, he goes up to third place then in this particular session. So we are seeing the fastest lap times of the day so far. This is interesting. So I wonder how much quicker the top guys will be going in the second session we have coming up shortly. Looking down the order, got Torres, Okubo, Zanoni down in fourth, Manfredi and Forres fifth, and then there's still more twitches coming out of turn three there. Herrera down in seventh place at the moment as well. She was busy in the summer break. Obviously doing 24-hour racing and won it, became the first female winner in the Catalunya 24-hour race. Very impressive indeed for her.
Yeah, pretty cool. A lot of these guys have been doing different things. I think, is that Smith, I think, at the edge of the track there. So I don't think Bradley is going to improve then at the end of this session, unfortunately. But yeah, I think we had, well, Matteo Ferrari was riding in the Italian Championship in the Super Sport to try and keep sharp. Mm. Maria Herrera obviously doing a bit of endurance racing.
The other riders that have headed for like World Super Sport and World Endurance, etc. It's Suzuka 8-Hour, of course, as well. Canepa was there, and Dominic Hegter, World Super Sport, etc. Eric Granado competing in Spanish superbikes. So here we go then. Across the line, Jordi Torres will come. I don't see on our timing screens that anybody else is going to make substantial enough improvements to maybe demote him or Cardalus. But they could put in a pretty special final sector. What is about this coming in from Zanoni, potentially? Well, he's up, so he could well be bumping Jordi Torres out. Can Zanoni, the Italian, keep this pace up? Near enough, everybody else crossed the line who is going to be of a threat. So Zanoni across the line, he will come. Young Kevin, will it be top two positions? It is. It's the first position. It's actually the second fastest time we've seen all day in MotoE. So it'll be him and Cardalus going straight through, and he's well chuffed with that. But someone who won't be chuffed one little bit is Jordi Torres, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's a bit of a blow for Jordi. Qualifying then 13th on the grid. Sorry, 11th on the grid for tomorrow. Not really ideal for him, but well, I think Granado last year proved that you can make a bit of a comeback at this track. And of course, as Cassidy said at the start of the session to Fran, two more overtaking points on this track potentially.
Yeah, exactly. Impressive how fast they're going through that chicane, actually. I thought with MotoE bikes, Moto2 and MotoGP, it would be a lot more stop and start, really, really slow. But you can see there, I mean, these MotoE bikes are quite notorious for being high corner speed, and they still carry it through there in that little stoppage.
It was also funny in the press conference on Thursday when I asked all the guys about the new chicane, and Eric Granado especially was just like, well, there's more corners. Riders love corners. Just an extremely enthusiastic, like, yeah, it's just great. So, yeah, I love that answer. Just the pure kind of Risa mentality immediately, like, two more places to break and try and attack.
Yeah, to be fair, if they don't like corners, it might as well be drag races. So, yeah, fair enough.
Yeah, certainly wasn't slowing them down much there in that session. Was the new chicane between turns one and three. Disappointment for Okubo, who's had a couple of big prangs in this class in the last few weekends. He had a huge crash at Mugello and then another one at Assen, and just running on here at turn three, not quite going to plan there.
Backed out of that and avoided another crash there at that moment in time, didn't he? So time for the top two to get their bikes just briefly recharged, a little bit of a cheeky top up, and they're getting ready for Q2 then. So Kubo coming in, number 78, fourth place for him. So yes, nine riders completing this session. Unfortunately, Alessio Finello out of action for the rest of this weekend.
It's surprising to see Mark Alcoba weighed on the order as well, Matt. He obviously put in a couple of surprise performances at Mugello and Assen, but then had that terrifying crash at Ramshoek on the final lap, I think, of race
he did,
one.
Didn't he? Yes, of course.
At the Dutch TT. You wonder whether there's any lingering after effects of that, because Alcoba being 1.5 seconds off is really not what we expected, I think. It's fair to say.
Tell you one thing, Neil. I mean, I'm barely recovered from the racing in Assen. I mean, well, actually, that's not true. I got a sustained recovery in the delays we had for race two, because race one was off the charts, wasn't it? More of that tomorrow, please. Riders out on the circuit, thank you very much. It's Kevin Zanoni then, top of the pile here. Second fastest time of the day so far. Cardalus with the third fastest time of the day so far as well. The third 1:41 on this new layout. They will be going through, but Torres will be lining up behind, so he'll be in P11 on the grid, if my calculations are correct. Kubo 12th and Frady 13th. Forres, Herrera, Smith, Alcoba, and no Alessio Finello. That's it. Q2 coming up next, everybody. Hope you are staying put, because the roll for pole is coming along very, very quickly. Don't go anywhere. summer of 69. Brian Adams playing. The start of Moto E, qualifying two. What more could you want? I'll tell you what more you could want, Neil. Lifestyles of the Rich and the Famous by Good Charlotte. No?
No.
No, no. But even though that's a joke, because that's been playing several times on the circuit speakers and like radio in the paddock yesterday for some bizarre reason. I love a bit of Good Charlotte here. Does anyone listen to Good Charlotte anymore?
I hope not.
Anyways, beautiful Red Bull Ring. Qualifying two coming up then. So this is the showdown for pole position. But yes, worth noting, plenty of the old big hitters here in this particular session. Cassaday, Aigerter and Granado were your top three at the end of combined free practice. In the championship, though, slightly different, of course, in the actual standings. It is coming into this race weekend. Dominic Aigerter leading the way from Eric Granado and Matteo Ferrari. Cassaday, fastest rider so far his this weekend, was fourth in the standings ahead of Pons, Canepa and Garzo. These are the riders then going through then. Riders from Q1, Granado, Pons, Canepa, Ferrari, Garzo and Alex Escrig. This is number 17, the youngster. This year's Fermin Aldeguer, you could call him. Also Fermin Aldeguer, last year's Alex Escrig. Depends on what fence you're on. He's in this session as well, the lanky youngster. So we await sort of big question. Who will be filling out the front row of the grid? But I tell you what, before we do actually get going, Neil, let's just have a little bit of a review, shall we, of the Assen weekend. I mean, wow. Some of the race we saw there, Assen is just built for sensational racing, isn't it? But then came across the finish line, you had top five riders all within one singular second after eight laps of Moto E racing. How brilliant was that?
Yeah, absolutely spectacular. Some of the best Moto E racing I think we had. I mean, we've been really lucky with the racing so far this year. Mugello was spectacular as well, as was Assen. And it was just a shame that we didn't really have the weather for race two, because we obviously had a few delays, and then that quite scary crash for Mikel Pons that brought out the red flags. And well, the rain was sort of on and off, and because of the delays we had to call a result essentially after I think two laps in race number two, which deprived us of you know what would have been another cracker, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, absolute corker, no doubt. Half points were awarded, in fact, most of the field. So Dominic Aigerter took away from race two 10 points, Eric Granado 13, and then Matteo Ferrari 6.5.
Yep, we're going to pass back down to Fran, who's got a bit of an update on Jordi Torres, who didn't make it through Q1. Fran?
I have, yes. Unfortunately, I can't bring you the interview because I was chatting to him in Spanish between the two sessions, and I thought I'll take my chance now while he's not doing his debrief. But he said he's feeling pretty okay, still a little bit of a twinge every now and then from his leg, and especially in changes of direction. So that gives him a split review of the chicane, which is, in general, great. For him specifically, struggling a little bit more in changes of direction, not so great. But yeah, he said, you know, obviously this year now, without chance of winning the cup, he's just taking it a little bit steady. But yeah, he's pretty okay. Seemed pretty good spirit. I mean, Jordy's always in good spirits, isn't he? But yeah, another good review for the chicane. And hopefully he says he'll try and fight for a bit more tomorrow and Sunday.
Nice one, Fran. I'm going to have to highlight that little humble brag that you just included there. I was just speaking to Jordi Torres in Spanish, so sorry I couldn't bring you the interview. But
intend to do that, but it came out, so I'm sorry. It's a reason for Matt to join us, isn't it, Neil, as an hispanohablante?
Yes. I can't wait for Fran to then bring us a Niccolò Canepa interview in Italian. And
Hikaru Kubo in Japanese as well.
Well, no, do you know who you need for that? Nicolas Goubert, the Moto E director, of course, fluent in Japanese, is the Frenchman. So, yes, that man speaks a lot of languages. You see, he transitions perfectly, like Italian, Spanish, French, English, Japanese as well. I mean, wow, he is a very, very impressive man. And I don't just say that because he's technically one of our bosses. Oh, wow. And he's a genuinely fantastic bloke. There is Niccolò Canepa then, fresh from, well, speaking of Japanese, the Suzuka 8-hour outing he had over there. Hopefully he's got over jet lag by now. And in about 3 seconds' time, this 10-minute session will be getting underway. Neil, I won't dwell on it too much, but the first rider heading out onto the track at the moment, Dominic Aigerter, the source of a bit of controversy in the summer break, the Moto E summer break, I should say.
Yeah, exactly. Tommy maybe didn't have his finest moment at the Czech World Superbike round where, well, he crashed. You know, he was part of a collision, wasn't he, in the first corner of the first Supersport race. Mm. And then I think he feigned injury in a hope of bringing out the red flags. The red flags were brought out.
Yeah.
And, well, turns out that he wasn't injured. But he was excluded from race two. He wasn't allowed to participate in race two. And, well, I mean, to be fair to him, he admitted that it was a mistake and he shouldn't have done that.
Correct.
But what had otherwise been such a perfect season, it's just a slight blemish, I think, for the Swiss rider with regards to that.
Yeah, I think it won't bang in too much for that. But let's just say, I mean, you want to change your Daytona boots for some Adidas studs and go play some football if you want to do things like that, basically, eh? But that's the end of that one. But yeah, it wasn't exactly a drama-free summer break for him. But he is still, of course, the leader in the World Supersport Championship as well. He's trying to get that World Supersport title and MotoE World Cup title all in the same year. The pressure's up. But if I was someone like Eric Granado, for example, Neil, how many points adrift is he? So sort of just around about 25-ish. He's got 126.5 points to his name. Domi has 158. If I was someone like Eric Granado, I'd be thinking, well, if he's pulling tactics like that, he's feeling the pressure somewhat. So I'm going to use that to my advantage and really pile the pressure on in this MotoE World Cup. Really push him into a mistake. What kind of things do I do? You know, that's maybe because I'd be a bit more of an evil competitor, but all's fair in love and war in MotoE.
Yep, it is. And, Granado does have to pull something special out of the hat with just this round and then the climax of this World Cup coming at Misano in 2 weeks' time. We've basically just got two rounds, four races left, and with Aigeter sporting an advantage in the championship of 31.5 points. I mean, technically, Matt, he could go into Sunday's race with match points.
Yes, exactly that. The Domi fighters are ready for a potential World Cup victory here this very weekend, just a stone's throw from his homeland in Switzerland, of course. So these are the first flying laps coming in then. But 100 points up for grabs. I mean, plenty can change during that time. So still, well, very much all to play for, including for the likes of Matteo Ferrari. Mattia Cassidy, a bit far adrift now, 60 points. That's not ideal, I would say. But he can certainly throw a cat amongst the pigeons. He's a seasoned winner now in the class, a regular podium finisher. So I'm sure we'll see him up there as well.
Yeah, great. Obviously, we're on board with Eric Granado, but just behind him is his teammate, Mikel Pons. Great to see Mikel back competing here because that was an ugly crash that he had at Assen. And he was hit by another motorcycle. We were a little bit worried about Mikel, but great to see that he wasn't badly injured, and he's made a pretty rapid recovery as well. So back on a bike here, just 7 weeks after that Dutch TT incident.
Yeah, that was important, wasn't it, as well? We were very much thinking of Mikel Pons at the time. So glad he's all okay, back out in action here as these first flying laps are coming in, checked off the box. Then Dominic Aigeter, your series leader, will be the first to cross the line with Matteo Ferrari just behind him, fully in the bubble. 141.955 from Garzo at the back of this quartet then.
Decent stuff from Garzo then. That's fairly close. I think that's the fourth fastest time we've seen so far today, but I'm sure that's all about to change. Here comes Eric Granado pitching in to the final turn. You can see he's gapped Mikel Pons rather substantially in the half lap or so, and Granado goes to the top of the standings with 42.0, but I think we're going to see some guys go even faster still.
Very faster as well. So that lap scratched off from the record books from Garzo then, so no 141s just yet, as we saw back in Q1, but a couple more attempts at that we will see. Here is Canepa, followed by Mattia Cassidy. Cassidy, the very much in-form rider in MotoE from earlier today. Canepa takes a look behind him. Ferrari goes up the inside of Dominic Aigeter. You can see the differences in line choices there, and actually running it wider, getting a bit more power through that rear wheel, keeping it more wide open. Might pay off, but certainly through that corner, but not in time overall. Looking very, very fast. He might even get round to like the 140s themselves, Neil.
Yeah, absolutely. Ferrari keeps this up. could well see a lap in the 1 minute 40s on this lap. You can see there nearly 0.9 seconds, huge margins halfway around the lap, but he doesn't quite nail it in sector number three. There's the number 11, still has a pretty decent chance of getting his second ever title in this category. Ferrari third overall, 45.5 points back, but needless to say, he needs to make some big ground at this round if he wants to go to Misano, one of his best tracks, of course, in 2 weeks' time, with a realistic hope of taking the crown.
So now we have a proper benchmark time then. The fastest lap so far today. I keep saying this weekend, it's Friday still. As we see, a 141.6, but Cassaday, he comes across the line now. 141.5 from the fastest rider from free practice then. The 27, very much in form, is the likeable Italian. Very close friends with Tatsuki Suzuki and MotoGP rider Enea Bastianini. But Granado, he's gone even quicker still. I think that 140 could be coming with 4 minutes left on the clock.
Yeah, Granado's been pretty handy in MotoE qualifying through the years, but he's yet to actually score a pole position this year. Could today be the first time we see the Brazilian marking his name on pole? And say he's in with a good chance, but I still think we're going to see lap times come down another couple of tenths of a second.
Granado's a bubble.
Big moment in the turn three, and you can see he sits up. That lap has gone away from him, but what about Ferrari and Egerton? He's good in this first half of the lap, is Ferrari, but sector three last time was where the time got away.
Yeah, it really goes to show how quick Granado was through that sort of split. That's the thing with sector three as well. It is so different to the rest of the track, far more fast and flowing, keeping it sort of wide open out of turn four through turn five, tipping it left, turns to six and seven, nailing your exit there. It's more about flow rather than stop and start nature of the other sectors. Through the final corner they come then, and will they regain any sort of time in the little short squirt to the straight, the finish line? No, they don't. But personal best lap times from both Ferrari and Aigata. Right now, your front row is Granado from Cassaday, and then Ferrari.
Yeah, pretty interestingly, Matt, the top four in qualifying at present are the top four in the championship. So all the contenders are looking pretty good at the moment in MotoE at the Red Bull Ring. Cassaday comes across the line, but doesn't manage to improve. We do expect the Italian to perhaps do something better perhaps at the close of this session, but has, you know, we know these soft tires, maybe the best is kind of passed for them, you know.
Could well be, as we, oh wow, proper real squirming the back wheel, squealing it even. That was Cassaday on entry to turn 2A, as Dominic Aigata bows out and lets Ferrari through. Ferrari on yet another good lap then. The second split could be good for him. Backing it in, wow, speedway style from Ferrari there then. Goodness gracious me, last time I saw a Ferrari that sideways was Top Gear when I was about 10 years old. Goodness me, that was sensational. But he's lost all the time in that second split then. But what about someone like Alex Escrig? Could he be an outside shout for maybe a front row?
Could well be, 0.4 seconds off. Although the top four currently are separated by 0.2 seconds. So Escrig really needs to nail these final two sectors. But he has had an impressive weekend so far as the number 17. Just behind Carlos at the moment. I don't think this is going to vastly improve his position. But he will get one more bite at the cherry.
How long are his legs? My goodness me. I mean, now he gets them tucked in. I have no idea. Across the line he will come then. The number 17 of Escrig goes stays in seventh, I should say then. So one rider still yet to properly settle up until now is actually Hector Garzo at 144.1, but he'll get one more crack at the whip now. Alex Escrig will not, because that's his last flying lap gone as he went over track limits. His teammate Garzo will do though, and so will Pons and Granado.
Yeah, it looks like good tactics here from the LCR boys, Pons and Granado. Granado led the Spaniard across the line for the first couple of laps, and now it looks as though the roles will be reversed and Granado will benefit from Pons' slipstream around this track. So let's see if Granado can cement his pole position. Advantage of just 0.14 at the moment over Cassaday.
Last flying laps coming in then. We've got red splits from Zanoni, Garzo, Ferrari and Aigata. What about Eric Granado? Out to B he comes. To be or not to be? It could be, because he's got another red split as well. So what are they looking like then? Is Aegerter's lost a bit of time in that second split. Ferrari's still under in that second split. But what about this key third one, the fast and flowing section then? We'll have to keep an eye on the riders behind him. It's a bit twitchy from Aegerter there. Keep it inside the track limits then, chaps.
Manages to do that, but that little bobble that he had coming out of turn six might have just upset him ever so slightly. And Aegerter, well, would love a place on the front row. I think all of these guys would be saying front row would be sufficient, but it wouldn't be the end of the world for Aegerter in fourth either. But Kevin Zanoni, he's the man to look out for, man. Just 6 thousandths off.
Yep, as Ferrari goes, tries to go out the inside of Garzo, but no way through for him. I think that's really going to scupper his lap from any sort of major improvements. But what about Granado? He's still in touch of his own best time, but if nobody else improves, that pole position will be his. No improvement from Aegerter, Ferrari, but what about Zanoni? He's the last one in touch. Garzo, he's miffed with that. P9 for him. It's going to come away from Granado too. So it looks like as Zanoni will head the second row, seems like it's pole position for the first time this year for Granado.
Granado comes across the line. His final lap doesn't manage to improve. Not that it matters though, because as Matt said, no one else managed to make significant ground up on him. So Granado will start Saturday and Sunday's races from pole position. The first time this year he's done that. The last time he started from the front row. In fact, the only time he started from the front row was at Assen this year. He came away with a second and a first. So that bodes well for the Brazilian.
Yeah, does indeed. And he put in a cracking performance here last year to get on the podium from way down on the grid. Will he be able to go better and keep that pressure on Dominic Aegerter? Can't let him to concede any more points to Domi in the world standings. Speaking of standings, quality stand-up wheelies inbound then on the rundown from turn three to turn four. Could have been an exciting session that one, Neil.
Yeah, good stuff there on from Kevin Zanoni, who obviously came through Q1, left it late, but his jump up to fourth in the times demoted Aegerter a spot. So I wonder if that'll play a crucial role in tomorrow's race for Aegerter. Will there be any kind of nerves from the Swiss rider as he attempts to put himself in a real commanding position? I would say, knowing what can happen at Misano, especially with last year in mind, also the strength of guys like this at Misano. Matteo Ferrari is a bit of a specialist around the that particular track. Aegerter will certainly be hoping to do the donkey work and go to the final races of the year with more than maybe 30 points in hand.
Well, into the pits the riders come then. That's it for MotoE today. We'll be hearing from them in Parc Fermé, of course, in due course, I should say. Fran Wild will be down there. I think I can see her already. She's ready and waiting for the riders in Parc Fermé. Sun's out as well, so none of that rain that was forecast for around about this time this afternoon eventually turned up. Today was meant to be rainy all day, but such is life in the mountains that it's changed a bit, which is nice. So Aegerter, your series leader, will in fact be starting from fifth position.
So there is your front row for tomorrow and Sunday. Happens to be the guys that are second, fourth and third in the championship as well. So a good day for the contenders, the men that are hoping to chase down Dominic Aegerter. You can see Eric Granado usually full of emotion and cheer. Camley assessing his performance there. No theatrics or hysterics from him. Just a case of job well done. Obviously the important stuff comes tomorrow and Sunday. Same for Matteo Ferrari. Not absolutely jubilant, but looks pretty content with his day's work.
Granado is, though.
Yeah.
Understandably so. His best chance yet since his first year, you could say, at potentially taking the title. Casadei will be as well. I'm always looking forward to MotoE races because they are always blockbuster. But especially looking forward to these ones now. There's Matteo Ferrari then. So third place on the grid for him tomorrow. How does he feel about that one, Fran?
Yes, indeed. Here is Matteo Ferrari. Well, congratulations. The front row is what you guys always say is the real key in MotoE. So is that third place mission accomplished for this weekend?
Yeah, really happy about this qualifying. The strategy was perfect because this morning I rode always alone, and I try to do my best. But when you are in qualifying with this guy, it's important to do this kind of lap every time in the front. And yeah, third position is perfect for me. Is inside for the first corner, so ready for tomorrow.
Well, best of luck.
Thank you. Ciao.
Yes, thank you very much. The ever pleasant and joyful Matteo Ferrari then. Front row, basically all you need here. Good job from him. Next up, we'll be speaking to another Italian and his close rival in various series from Italy to MotoE around the world, Mattia Cassadei then. So the fastest rider in free practices up until qualifying. But I'm sure second place will do, as that's the main thing. Heading, front row being the main thing heading into tomorrow and Sunday's race. He's down there in Parc Fermé with Fran. Take it away.
He is indeed. So, Mattia, you had a bit of an advantage in free practice. Eric just got you in qualifying, but still, middle of the front row, job well done, ready to go out there and attack from that first row, right?
Yeah, very good job this day in Austria. I'm very happy. I do a good job with the guys of the team with the bike. We are ready for tomorrow. A very good front row. I'm happy, and tomorrow I do my best.
Full gas or the electric version?
Thank you.
Full throttle, full power would be the one, wouldn't it? So Cassadei then, 27. Great stuff from him. One of the better helmet designs, I would say, as well, in all of the Grand Prix paddock, in fact. Very simplistic, very nice indeed. Will Cassadei be able to get his second victory here of the season in MotoE? Of course, that last victory was back in Le Mans. First race, putting himself into series contention. That crash in race two in Mugello, that long finish, really didn't help him in that front. But I tell you what, Eric Granado, so far finished every race. He's on pole for the first time this year. How does he feel about that one, Fran?
So, Eric, another pole position. As you are hunting down Domi as the closest challenger at the moment, I imagine the mission was minimum front row, but pole position, great job. How are you feeling? What's your approach?
Yes, very happy. We did a great job today in wet conditions and dry too. Finally, in this last session, I could do a clean riding. You know, I was a little bit not on the rhythm in the first session with the dry conditions, and also in the new chicane, I was not with the flow, and now I could have a good feeling, and I improved a lot my lap time from the morning. So yeah, I was very happy. We did the first mission, like you said. The target was the front row, finally the pole position, the first one for me this season, so very happy. And I want to continue on this way during all the weekend and try to do the maximum points possible and continue stretching our dream that's arriving in the last race with possibilities to win. So yeah, happy, and let's go like this more.
Parabéns.
Obrigado.
Obrigado. Thank you, Eric. Good to see you then. Well, bring on tomorrow's race then. Qualifying and race day here at the Austrian Grand Prix. Can't wait for that one, Neil.
Yeah, going to be a great day. The last couple of MotoE races that we've had are anything to go by. It will be box office viewing. You will not want to miss the first race of the weekend. And then, of course, the second one coming up after the three Grand Prix on Sunday. Could we see a champion crowned this weekend here in Austria?
Always possible. Always possible. But for the sake of entertainment, the sport, longevity, I hope not. These are then the final results from qualifying there. Pole position, Eric Granado, a 1 minute 41.390 gave him P1 ahead of Cassadei and Ferrari joining them on the front row. The Italian stallions continue as Zanoni heads the second row of the grid from fourth place ahead of Aigata and Canepa. Then just behind him, you have Cardalus and Pons. Alexis Skrieg and Hector Garzo round out the top 10. Torres will start behind them, along with Kubo, Manfredi, Forres and Maria Herrera. Bradley Smith and Mark Alcoba round out the 17 riders that will be racing tomorrow in the MotoE World Cup for, well, the penultimate round. 100 points still left up for grabs. You guys won't want to miss it. Thanks for joining us today for all the action from myself, Neil, Fran, Amy, Simon, Lewis and Matt Burt. Auf Wiedersehen. Ciao.